I wanted to thank Yudha and Benny for giving me this opportunity. This actually straight off the, you know, like off the press, we just submitted this like a couple of weeks back, and Abhi and I were like incredibly excited about this work. I should tell that, you know, like Yudha says, I grew up, you know, in the research field thinking that zero knowledge solves everything. I mean, you know, what's left? But, you know, over the past year, I've attended at least three practical MPC workshops, and I have to rethink everything. All right, so let me start about talking about this. There's been quite a bit of hype about this title, especially if you look at your proceeding. It says, Rethinking for Secure Computation. It sounds grander. But let me start. All right, so over the past week, we've seen a lot of tools to do efficient, secure computation. My weak attempt at abstracting the stuff that we have seen says you want to securely compute a functionality F. You compile it to Boolean circuits, arithmetic circuits, ORAM, OPRAM, and then use some generic approaches to securely compute these functionalities. Now, how do we decide what approach to use? Well, I'm going to use the answer that's been used throughout this workshop. Well, it depends. It depends on what your requirements are and what your application is. But for certain functionalities, for instance, the Benny's talk from yesterday on private set intersection, it's a specific problem for which people have tried to find very efficient techniques. And the flavor of this talk is going to be somewhat generic and somewhat specific. All right, so I should say again, following the trend of this workshop, I'm going to pose some questions that for which you will get beers. So I'm going to start with this really beautiful work that appeared in Eurocrypt 2004 from Benny's group. And this was about, you want to securely compute the median. Say Alice and Bob have a set of inputs of different sizes, let's say, and they want to securely compute the median among their sets of data. Now, this is sort of an algorithmic picture of how this is done. If you look, it's an iterative algorithm. It starts with Alice and Bob locally computing the medians in their individual sets of data, and then securely, I'm usually bad with the pointer, so I'm not going to use it. So, and then securely comparing the medians, okay? So Alice finds MA, Bob finds MB, they securely compute, and there are two outcomes of this computation. Either it's less or it's greater than equal to. Now, if MA is less than MB, you need to think about this. You have Alice's data set and Bob's data set, and if MA is less than MB, it means that the median has to be bigger than MA and smaller than MB, eventually. So what Alice and Bob do is Alice removes the top half, which is removes all elements from her data set that are smaller than MA, and Bob removes all the set of elements that are bigger than MB. And then they recurse. Okay? So if you think about it, at every step, your data set comes down by half, and you compute the median in the remaining set, and you go on. Now, at the end, you'll be left with one element. You do a comparison, and you actually reveal what the median is. So in all the iteration, you don't reveal anything. You just reveal the outcome of the comparison. And at the last step, you reveal what the answer is. And this beautiful approach actually computes the median. And what more is that the number of rounds of iteration is log n, because you decrease by half. And the communication complexity, because if you look at what is being securely computed, is just a comparison operator. It is just the classic Yao's millionaire. The communication complexity of this actually approaches the communication complexity of computing the median itself. And I think this is like sort of an outlier in this space of how we construct secure computation, but I think it's a really fantastic piece of work. So I'm going to sort of do a walkthrough with an example. I should thank Benny for giving me his slides for explaining this work. All right, so Alice and Bob have their set of databases. Now at each step, Alice and Bob compute the median in their local data set. They compare, and depending on the outcome, in this case, MA is less than MB, or maybe not, you recurse into the halves. So, and you iteratively do this. And finally, you at the last stage, you're left with one element that you compare, and you get the answer. All right? So this is great. We have a secure compute. Well, we have a protocol to compute the median. Now the question is this secure? It's done iteratively, and at every stage, something is being revealed about the data sets. The outcome of the secure comparison is being revealed. So the question is this secure? So let's think about this. We're going to think about this in the semi-honest case. Now let's just look at Alice's data set, and remember, we know what the simulation paradigm that we want to do to prove security. So let's say that I'm trying to simulate a corrupt Alice. Now, with her input and the median, I want to know if I can recreate this sequence of steps. Can I simulate this interaction? But what does it mean to simulate this interaction? It means I need to know the outcome of the secure comparison in every step. Now, the beautiful part of this approach is that with the actual answer, the median, you know what the outcomes of each of these comparisons have to be. Because remember, the median was always in between this MA and MB. So the result of the comparison with respect to the median and one of these parties would result in the same outcome. So this proves semi-honest security of this protocol. Okay, and we'll sort of revisit this a little later because this protocol actually has some more interesting properties. So let me reiterate here. So what is the function that you want to, you need to securely compute to implement this functionality? It's just comparison, it's just millionaire. Every step you just do a millionaire computation securely. Okay, it's a very simple primitive, you can do like make it very efficient. All right, so what else can we compute using millionaire? So this is the question that we started, we wanted to think about. And in our work, actually, we show that we can do a whole lot of things that we can securely compute, where in each iteration, all we are going to do is a comparison. So the examples are convex hull, minimum spanning tree, some job scheduling problems, Dijkstra, and some approximation algorithms, okay? Now, just a snapshot of our results here. I want to point out like what we are trying to achieve here in terms of communication complexity. I mean, that was one of the important achievements of the secure median protocol. And here, to tell you how to read this table, our work, L you should think of, okay. I have it written. You should think of the input size. So if you have the convex hull, it's the set of points, the number of points that you have in your database. O should be thought of as the output size. So in the convex hull setting, it's not that all points are going to be in the convex hull, it's just the number of points in the convex hull. And L, you should think of it as the integer representation. If you're going to represent the coordinates, you should think L is the number of bits required to represent the coordinates. Okay. So we show that in many cases, actually in almost all of these cases in the semi-honest setting, we can get it to be proportional to the output size. Now, in the convex hull, it's the number of points on the hull. In the minimum spanning tree, I've written V times L because if you have a graph on n vertices, the size of your minimum spanning tree is order n. It's n minus 1 edges. Yes, Yuta. Yes, we are talking about, in all these computations, Alice and Bob share whatever the data set is, and they want to do these computations on the union of their data sets. Okay. And if you look at the analogous circuit or ORAM implementation, you have like additional overhead. I should point out that the convex hull, I've written it as I log I, which is the input times log of the input size. I'm not quite sure if that is true. I have to verify. There is this thing about oblivious algorithms that helps you achieve this. I know for the sorting you can do it, but I'm not quite sure for the convex hull. But anyways, just to be conservative, I put it as I log I there. And if you look at the ORAM techniques, almost all of them have a log cubed. If you want to convert an ORAM to a secure computation, you have a log cubed overhead. There's also a peculiar thing that I have here, and that's the first beer question I have. For the minimum spanning tree, I've written that the circuit requires, there is this function alpha. Who here can guess what this function alpha is? And just like Ellet mentioned, you have to go back to your basics. When you went to do your undergrad and you learned algorithms, what was the best algorithm or the best data structure that you needed for the minimum spanning tree? Yes, and Yuda gets the first beer. It is the inverse Ackermann function. You had to use the union find data structure, which was Tarjan's algorithm, which required proportional to the inverse Ackermann function. All right. V is the number of vertices, E is the number of edges. So this is sort of a snapshot of what we get. I mean, in terms of, I would say the goal here is we're trying to minimize the communication complexity, or the way I'd like to think about it is that it's yet another data point to construct secure computation of these protocols. Okay? So what paradigm abstracts all these algorithms? Next question. Just, in fact, I mean, you can just think about minimum spanning tree, Dijkstra, even if you don't know the approximation algorithms, that's fine. What paradigm abstracts the like textbook 101 algorithms to compute each of these things? The greedy algorithm, okay, too many beers. All right. So what are greedy algorithms in an abstract sense? Well, you iteratively try to find an optimal choice locally. You want to and hope for the best. And amazingly, this approach actually gives you optimal solutions in all these cases. The convex hull, I mean, the n log n algorithm is not this, but there is one, what is known as the Jarvis march, that you iteratively find the convex hull, which does find the optimal convex hull. In MST, you have the Kruskal and the Prim, both of which can be casted in the greedy framework. Many variants of job scheduling. Dijkstra's algorithm is, in fact, another in this in the class of greedy algorithms. And submodular function approximation is also the case. You can't compute it optimally unless p not equal to np, I guess. But I should point out here that when I say a greedy, when I'm going to securely compute these things, there is another notion of private approximations, which is not what we do here. All that we are saying here is that the particular greedy algorithm that computes the approximations for set cover and all these cover-related problems, we securely implement it. OK. So this is our sort of framework that will help us get secure algorithms for all the problems that was listed in the previous slide. And I'm going to say that a greedy problem or a function corresponding to a greedy algorithm is going to be compatible with our framework if the following three things hold. The first, we need a unique solution. Now, this can be made sort of without loss of generality. Actually, Benny has some ideas in his median case where also he needs unique data points. You can convert your points so that they are unique in some sense. Another thing that we need is unique order, meaning that the greedy algorithm needs to output this in a unique order, okay? Now, I'm going to use the minimum spanning tree as an example because it's one of the classic greedy algorithms. And if you want to get unique order, I claim that if the weights that you're going to do in your tree are distinct, then you automatically get a unique solution. And the final property, which is going to be very crucial for us, is what is known as a local updatability. We're going to have Alice and Bob securely compute this function, and somehow your greedy local search needs to be decomposable among the different set of points. okay? And with the focus here that combining these things is usually a less than operation. So you have this capital function f, which sort of does the greedy local search, okay? So the small f is computing the optimal. So let's say the small f function gives you C1 through CL is the output, the optimal solution. Capital F on a union of databases actually finds iteratively, according to a unique order, outputs the optimal solution. And finally, the local updatability says that, well, if I want to find the optimal local at every step in U and V, where Alice is going to hold U and Bob is going to use V, they should be able to do it locally, and then just by a comparison, find out what should be the next step. Okay? So if these three properties are satisfied, then we have a general secure computation protocol to implement the greedy algorithm. Okay? All right, so I just prepared my slides last night, so I was a little lazy. I just copy-pasted from my paper. So this is our general framework for computing it securely. So Alice has her set of inputs U, Bob has his set of inputs V. Iteratively, they apply the F function, and they're going to do it L times, where L is going to be the output size. And at each stage, they're going to locally get what the minimum values are, let's say UA and VB. And we're going to say each of these items actually have a key. For instance, in the minimum spanning tree, your element is the edge, and the key is the cost of the edge. And you do a comparison operation on the cost, and you output what is the minimum. In this sense, it's a little different from Benny's secure median protocol, because there, you only output the result of the computation, just less than or greater than. But here, in addition to that, you also reveal what the answer is. Okay? And just to make it clear, the less than function is essentially just comparing the keys and outputting which has the lesser value. Okay? Now, why is this correct? So we know that our small f function computes the optimal. We know that from the unique order property, this capital F iteratively outputs this. And since Alice and Bob, we are considering them to be semi-honest adversaries here for the time being, they are going to compute the local update function individually because this F is known. But by our local updatability property, that gives exactly what we want for achieving the optimal solution. Okay, now how are we going to get simulation? We want to prove semi-honest security. Well, the simulator is going to get, let's say we're going to simulate Alice, we get the input and we get the output. Now, what does it mean to simulate in this case? Well, it means that you need to know in each of these individual secure computation protocols, what the output is. You know what the input is going to be because you know what Alice's algorithm is, but you need to know what the output is. But luckily, by our properties, we have unique solution in unique order. We know exactly what the output of each iteration is. So we can achieve semi-honest security. All right. Oops, that was a punchline. Never mind, one beer question down the drain. In Introduction to Algorithms at the undergraduate level, we learn greedy and everything. But in an advanced algorithms, we actually have a framework for a lot of these greedy problems. And the abstract mathematical structure to capture greedy algorithms is what is known as matroid set systems. So there are some job scheduling problems, there are the minimum spanning tree and a couple of others for which you can cast it as a matroid set system and then say that the greedy algorithm actually gives the answer. Okay? So what is a matroid set system? Well, it comes with a set of elements S and a family of subsets of S denoted by I, which usually represents the subset of independent sets. Okay? Now, what are the two properties that we need for a matroid set system? Well, first is the hereditary property, which says that if a particular subset is an independent set, that means belongs to I, then any subset of it also belongs to the set system. And the second thing, which is the crucial property both are crucial. The interesting property of matroids is the exchange property, which basically says you take two independent sets, A and B, of different sizes. Let's say that the size of B is bigger than the size of A, These are two independent sets. You can pick an element from B and sort of grow A. Okay? Now, I would say when you want to think about matroids, think about the minimum spanning tree. You have, say you have two trees, one is smaller than the other. You can always add an edge from the bigger tree to the smaller tree to grow it. Okay? Now, the class of problems that we are investigating are weighted matroids, where all these elements come with costs. And we know that, so this is the classic theorem that says that, well, the greedy algorithm finds the maximal independent set with minimum cost. Okay? Some examples of matroids. Well, think of M, you can think of a matroid built from a matrix of elements, where S can be, the elements can be thought of as the rows, and independent sets can be actually thought of linear independent subset of these rows. Okay? And you can easily verify both the hereditary property and the exchange property. The second one, which is what I'm more interested in, is the minimum spanning tree, where you consider the set of edges in a graph to be the elements, and the set of independent set are the set of forests, okay? If you don't know what a forest is, it's a bunch of trees, so. And in this case, the greedy algorithm, the maximal independent set is actually the complete tree on the set of vertices. Okay, it does require that your graph to begin with is connected, but the maximal independent set in that case would be a tree. Okay? All right, so how does the greedy algorithm for matroids work? That's simple. You have a set system and a weight function. You start with an empty set. This is going to be eventually, the set A is going to be the maximal set that you're looking for. At each step, what you do, you pick that element in the set of elements S that is of, in decreasing order of costs, and such that you can grow A so that it remains independent, okay? And now, why does such an element exist? Because of the exchange property, you can always add. And just iteratively computing this at each stage, you are going to find the element of maximum cost. Actually, I reversed the order, but you can do both minimal and maximal here. So you're doing it in decreasing cost here. So you find the next element of maximum cost and you add it to your set. It's a very simple greedy heuristic, okay? Now, I want to say that this any matroid where the greedy algorithm here works, it's secure greedy compatible, meaning that it falls in our framework if we have the two properties. Like the three properties that I mentioned, I said unique solution and unique order. Well, this you can sort of get it by if you assume that the weights are distinct. But I should point out here that there are two algorithms for minimum spanning tree. There's Kruskal and there is Prim. And actually, interestingly, this greedy algorithm can only give the Kruskal's algorithm. It doesn't give the Prim's algorithm. Because in the Kruskal's, you arrange the edges and then you consider one after the other, as opposed to in the Prim that you grow a tree and always find an edge to grow a tree. Okay? And surprisingly, we are able to, well, we could do both the algorithms, but the Kruskal is going to be better for our case. Okay? And local updatability property, this is also important. And it's not necessary that we always have this, but for the minimum spanning tree and for the examples that we consider, we do have this. So how do we test that? How do we test if a set is in the independent set in the minimum spanning tree? Well, independent sets are forests, which means that if I can add a particular edge, I can check whether if it will remain independent by checking if there will be cycles. Okay? If there won't be cycles, then that edge is good. So that's why we can locally compute the next step. Okay? So matroids can be cast in our framework if these two properties hold, and for the examples that we show, it does hold. Okay? Now the next question is, okay, I gave you my algorithm, I proved semi-honest security, and I said matroids work here, but can we achieve malicious security? Okay? And unfortunately, the answer is no. And the reason here is that we are iteratively revealing, gradually revealing the answer. And what this means is that an adversary can adaptively decide, let's say even just to abort, based on the computation that has progressed this far. And if you think about simulating, it's not clear how you can do this, okay? Now, I want to revisit this problem of the secure median computation because this is, again, an interesting algorithm where you can achieve malicious security, okay? And remember, the difference between malicious and semi-honest is that, well, you need to generate views that are indistinguishable, but an important component is that you need to extract the party's input, okay? Now, in this, in the secure median computation, if I wanted to prove in the malicious setting, let's say that I want to simulate Alice, I need to extract, okay? I need to extract Alice's input. And in Benny's paper, they show actually there's a beautiful way of doing it just by running the secure computation a whole bunch of times. And I'm just going to put a picture that I got from their paper and sort of give you a high level of how that is achieved. So what you do is that if you want to simulate Alice, you fix what the outcome of the secure computation is. Okay? So remember, every element can be the outcome of the secure median. So if you think of the results of the secure computation as a tree, like yes and no as two choices, you will see that if you complete this tree, you can find out what the element is in every position of Alice. You just have to find out, you just have to develop this whole tree. You run through Alice a whole bunch of times and make so and give the answers to the secure computation in each of these iterations so that you go to that particular leaf. And in that leaf, that value is revealed. Okay? Now, this doesn't quite give you fully malicious in the sense that the adversary can also abort, in which case you won't develop the tree completely. But even in that case, you can simulate it. What happens is that you will have a whole bunch of subtrees that are not available, but you can put fake inputs there and still get the actual answer and do the computation. So this is fully malicious secure. Okay? So coming back to our example, we are not able to get fully malicious. So we're going to do the next best thing. Let's try to achieve covert security. And there's this paper by Oman and Lindell where they show, they formally define different notions of covert security. I've just put one of these. And I think this is a really good paper. I mean, I enjoyed reading how to formally define covert security. And this is just one definition in their paper. And roughly what it says is that the distinguishing gap between the simulation and the real, at least with epsilon probability of that distinguishing gap, the cheater must be detected. Okay, that's roughly what it says here. The epsilon times distinguishing gap must be the probability with which at least Alice can say that Bob is corrupt. Okay? Now, what are we going to do? Well, we are going to iteratively reveal the answer, and now to achieve covert security, we're going to say at the end, each party needs to prove that the greedy local update was done correctly. Okay, you're just going to prove. How much time do I have? Sorry.
2 minutes.
I have 2 minutes? All right, okay, so I'm going to go quickly here. So, all right. So, to solve the adaptively selected inputs, you can use commitments. Failure to follow the greedy update, well, the adversary can use the inputs out of order, or in fact, he can also fail to use some of his inputs that he committed. Okay, so these are a couple of problems. The idea is we use signatures and consistency checks. Now, I don't have too much time, so actually, I'm not going to give you my protocol for this, but I just want to explain how do you do consistency checks. How do you prove that, how does an adversary prove, or how do you enforce an adversary to prove that he locally computed the greedy update at every step. Okay, so for every input commitment you make, you show that either it was part of the output or it's not part of the optimal solution. Okay, remember that we have a unique solution, so the inputs can be only in one of these two categories. All right, for the convex hull, I'm going to give you a way to show this. Now think that this is a point that's not of the convex hull. It means that it's around here. How do I show that this is not part of the convex hull? Well, I'll show that there are three points on the convex hull such that this is inside. Okay? And so this is like order constant number of output elements that I need to show each point is not part of the optimal. Okay? For matroids, also we can do this. And think of the minimum spanning tree. If I want to show that a particular edge is not in it, then what do? I actually show that the cost of this edge when I add it to the optimal solution is bigger than every other element in the cycle form. Okay? This is the minimum spanning tree. All right. And I'm out of time. In fact, this can be extended to matroids as well. There is a notion of a cycle in a matroid. And I am out of time. So I'm just going to tell this, and I'm going to go to the last slide. Okay? So there is a you can do an efficient consistency check for minimum spanning tree. And this actually uses the Tarjan's union find to show that the size of the witness that you need to prove the greedy local update is log n if you want a simple algorithm. But if you use Tarjan's union find, the number of elements that you need is very, very small. Okay, and I thought this was a really cool thing that I used from my algorithms. You can see our paper for what we achieved. And let me just conclude. So this is just yet another data point to get secure computation. We are leveraging techniques from algorithms. We use only secure computation of comparisons here. For covert security, we need something more. But for semi-honest, we just need comparisons. There are a lot of open problems here. What about other primitives besides comparison? And what about other paradigms? Can you get dynamic programming? Can you get randomized algorithms? And with that thought, I'll leave you guys. Thanks.